exploring the bizarre, your e-ticket ride into the world of the paranormal. Strap yourself in as we traverse the universe, exploring the unexplained. UFOs. Ghosts. Lost worlds. Cryptozoology, as well as other dimensions. It's time to take back the night. Now, your electrifying hosts of Exploring the Bizarre, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Major Tim, take your protein pills and put your helmet on. Hey, so Tim, are you with us tonight? We're going, you know where we're headed?
Where are we heading this time, Tim?
Well, we've told people that we're going to take them all over the galaxy, and we sure in the heck are going to take them off planet Earth tonight. We're going to Mars.
All right.
And I don't mean the place in Pennsylvania where they make the candy bars. I'm talking about that red planet in the sky, the known, I guess, throughout history as the god of thunder and war, and a place where even some of the ETs supposedly came from in the early 1950s and established contact with people like George Adamski and George Van Tassel, if you are inclined to believe those stories. And, of course, at Exploring the Bizarre, we are inclined to believe a heck of a lot of things because we suspend our believability at least for 2 hours every week and bring you some of the most dynamic programming in the arena of UFOs and the paranormal. Isn't that right, Tim?
That's right. Well, and, you know, it's not like we suspend our believability. It's just that we enjoy letting everybody have a chance to tell their story. And we leave it up to our audience then to decide for themselves.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, Tim, tell us about our guest tonight.
Oh, we've got a great we have two fantastic guests.
We have two. Excellent.
Well, that's right. Well, we have Frank Jacob, who is an award-winning filmmaker and visual artist, and most recently he has released a feature documentary called Packing for Mars, which, by the way, won the People's Choice Award at the 2016 EB Film Festival. And with us also tonight is Tonia Madenford, who is an executive producer, and Tonia is the driving force behind the cutting-edge motion picture company Screen Addiction LLC, and she's produced films at various budget levels and divide your time between working on major Hollywood motion pictures and independent features. And we're going to be talking about the documentary Packing for Mars, which was inspired by the 1970s British television documentary, and then the novel that was written based on that, or some people say that it wasn't a novel. I know the author himself said that he went into it as a novel, but then some unusual things happened to him that kind of convinced him that maybe that there was something else going on. So
I know the book, Tim, has caused a great deal of controversy, and and the program. I have seen it. It's available kind of on a grainy bootleg because I think it was shown once on the BBC, correct me if I'm wrong, and then it kind of like, even though it did fairly well in the ratings, it kind of got shoved aside and was never officially aired again. I kind of put it in the same category, I guess, as maybe our War of the Worlds, which I don't think anybody is saying is really based on a true story, but alternative three may be. But anyway, our guests are not around the corner. They may not be as far as Mars, but they're not exactly next door either. Tonia, where are you calling us from? You and...
Frank and I are Skyping in from Bavaria, our little post-production studio here in the Alps. Well, I'm really glad to join you.
It sounds absolutely gorgeous. I know I've seen some photos on Facebook, and I must say that I'll trade you places at least for a week. Is there one photo of you that's sitting on top, standing on top of a mountain somewhere?
Yes, Mount Untersberg, and literally the studio's at the base of Mount Untersberg, and that's quite a magical place.
Mm-hmm. And what makes it so magical?
Well, it's a location that is known for time portals and vortexes and strange anomalies and legends that date back to the 1800s and strange, high strangeness, you could say.
UFO sightings there?
Indeed. They've had a lot of sightings of craft flying into the rock faces here. There's legends of dwarves and little people and a sleeping king. That would be me.
That would be me.
Hitler actually has his eagle nest here, actually, and he invested in a lot of observational equipment to watch this mountain, which sits across from Untersberg. So it's a very mystical, magical place. The Dalai Lama actually calls it the heart chakra of the planet. And he comes out here, he considers it like magical mountain or mystery mountain. But what's very fascinating about Mount Untersberg is it doesn't have a lot of seismic activity. It's like, you could call it like the foundation stone of the planet. So it's very rooted. And so there's lots of tales of, you know, 450 tunnel systems and caves and even tunnel systems running to the inner earth. So it's very fun to dive into that world.
Oh, my goodness. Well, now, how did you, were born here in the United States?
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
You were from Sedona? You lived in Sedona?
Arizona is actually where Screen Addiction is based. Yes. I love Sedona. Sedona's my old stomping grounds. Mm-hmm. And I was actually born in California. I'm a California girl. And mm-hmm. I came out here to Bavaria, teamed up with Frank, to do quite a few films out here. Klaus Donner Chronicles is one, and Klaus Donner is based in Vienna. And then we did a film called Solar Revolution with Dieter Burrows, best-selling author out of Germany. And Dieter's also located in Austria and Germany. And then, of course, Packing for Mars, which was Frank's huge journey that he started 5 years ago, which began here in Europe and then ventured out into the States.
And you did do a UFO documentary as well, correct?
Oh, quite a few of them. You know, I love Jose Escamilla. We've done mm-hmm. several films together.
Well, you know, Jose mm-hmm. gave his first public talk at one of my conferences in Phoenix, Arizona.
Aww.
He was still based down in Roswell, and I was editing at UFO Universe magazine, which I did for 11 years, and he sent me some photographs and a letter describing what he had seen and managed to take pictures of. And I can't say I was astonished. I mean, he got some good shots, but I was well familiar with the work of Trevor James Constable, who mm-hmm. also took photos of what he described as
critters,
space critters. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I don't know if they're in the same family as the rods, but they probably are from a dimension apart. So, Tim. You were going to ask them how they actually got hooked up with the Mars project.
Well, yeah. Well, we better bring Frank into the conversation.
Oh, absolutely. Then, you know?
Frank, how you doing tonight?
Hi, how you doing, Tim and Tim?
It's great to have you with us.
Great to be on the show.
Well, okay. Now, I know Tim wanted to, start out with, why you decided to make this film, but I want to ask you first, I mean, how did you get involved in filmmaking in the first place?
Well, it all started with music for me. I was mm-hmm. a musician, and I was involved in, of course, writing music and playing music and performing music, and that led to working with the technology to record music on computers, which eventually led to the actual enabling us to record video and edit them on computers in much similar kind of an interface. And I always kind of saw myself as being sort of a multimedia artist, and I wanted to get into visuals, but they really didn't become available to the public that, you know, until much later, of course. So now every day, you know, now it's affordable to go out and buy decent camera equipment. And there's great editing software, and I've been at it now for quite a few years. So I've basically, it's been a long process.
It really is amazing how the technology has changed. You know, when I first got into television production, I mean, I was working for places that were still using 16 millimeter cameras. And we're just at that point of getting into, you know, like 3/4 inch and 1 inch videotapes. And like you said, now you can download programs onto your computer that we would have wept.
Sure. I mean, 16
you know, 20 years ago,
now,
Sam, yeah.
Exactly. Like 16 millimeter now is a vintage look. You know, it's cool to have like that old vintage 16 millimeter thing going on in your video edits, you know.
Well, I tell you something, as you well know, anybody who ever had to fight with trying to edit a 16 millimeter film just, you know, like on the fly. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. Well, you know, the thing is, I started on 8 millimeter film. That was my first film ventures were on 8 millimeter. My parents, like a lot of parents, and you know, in the 70s, had sort of, you know, like when cameras, film cameras became available, started running around filming all of the summer vacations and everything. So, you know, my dad had even had a little edit suite, like a little mini 8 millimeter film edit suite. And my first film was actually cut on one of those things. And I know exactly what you're talking about. The good thing about it is that it forces you to make decisions about what you're shooting. You have to be more accurate than nowadays. Nowadays, there's this motto, you know, we'll just fix it in post. So people shoot so much material that the editors are just pulling out their hair going, how many more takes are this of this?
I know. I mean, you sat there, you know, like you said, I was the same way. I started with 8 millimeter, you know, doing both wet and dry splices. And, you know, when it doesn't hold and you have to go back and, you know, shorten your material a little bit because the edit broke. Well, okay, let's get off to that then. And let's just dive right into it then. What prompted you to make your film about Mars?
Well, you were mentioning earlier Alternative 3. Mm-hmm. And I had been I've been dabbling sort of in alternative healing for a few years, and I got to know this sort of biodynamic farmer in Canada. And one night we were discussing some things, and then he pulls out this book, Alternative 3, and starts going on about how this is like this, you know, mysterious chapter in the 70s where they brought out this thing and it was supposedly fiction, but apparently it was not. It was actually fiction masking the truth, and that there was this whole television show around it, and it totally intrigued me. It gave me the book and I read it, and it's an amazing read because it, you know, the author, Leslie Watkins, was a Fleet Street reporter. And he basically wrote the book based on the television show, and he went much deeper. And he wrote it as a fiction, but later, as you were mentioning, what happened is that he seemed to have, in his, you know, in the research behind making the book believable as kind of a, you know, just a fictional story, but as if it was talking about the truth, actually had stumbled upon things that were just freaking out researchers who were actually in the field. To the point where he was even getting, after the book was published, he had politicians calling him, he had scientists, he had journalists, and they refused to believe. They even called him a coward for a set of, you know, denying that it was true. I mean, there's interesting paper clippings, and I did a really great interview with him, like almost now, I guess, 40 years after the fact, which you can get on our website, which is definitely worth a listen to, because I sort of get down to the nitty gritty of like what really did go down here. Anyway, the book was sort of in my mind for many years, but I didn't do anything about it, and I certainly never thought I was going to make a documentary based around it. But it wasn't until, I think, a few years later, I'd been kind of developing, you know, I'd gone into music, into visuals, and I was editing for a network, and I was looking to sink my teeth into something that was kind of like the full expression, a film and, you know, music. I could write the music for it and the story behind it, and I needed something good to do that with, and it had to be something out of the ordinary. And out of the blue, I catch an interview with Laura Eisenhower, And I thought, what is this? Is this really true? Like, she's talking about being recruited for Mars. And I thought, okay, now this does this mean alternative three totally is true? And it really caught my interest. So I decided to try and reach her. And I figured I wanted to find out if she's really Laura Eisenhower or like somebody posing or whatever. I didn't know anything at this point, but I thought
is she?
She is. And I sort of made this pact with myself that if I can somehow reach her and she responds, that it's sort of a sign from the universe that this is the topic I need to make the film on. And she did. I reached out to her. She got back to me. She was excited about somebody doing something like this. And I basically got the backpack and the camera rig going, and I went out on the road to film this. It was a road movie. And that led me to, of course, run into Tonia Madenford very quickly in the project. So the two of us became kind of like this Scully and Mulder pursuing this crazy story.
And I imagine that the two of you had no idea what you were getting into. Because I know when you start a project like this, boy, it's just like everything just comes out from the woodwork.
Well, exactly. I mean, I thought it was going to be straightforward in a certain way, in some naive way, you know, just get the camera set up, witnesses will appear, but actually it was anything but. And it just kept getting crazier and crazier. And originally I thought it would be a few people, and then Tonia being the, you know, expert producer that I, through total serendipity, I met somebody while I was on the road filming who actually knew and produced, not only knew, but actually produced the films of some of the characters I wanted to, you know, have, that inspired me to get out and make the film in the first place, in this case, Jose Escamilla and others. That actually had produced their products, so their films, and thought, wow, this is great. And so she urged and pushed me to look for more and more people and information and cross connect. We had, you know, the thing took 5 years to make. You got to realize that there's been a lot of timelines that have been created over the course of those 5 years.
Tonia, why don't you tell us a little bit about Alternative 3? I mean, we know it's about Mars, but let's get a little bit more specific about it. Didn't some of the people that were interviewed for the show on British TV disappear mysteriously, or they were assassinated?
Well, Alternative 3 is a very interesting story. And as you had mentioned earlier, it really was like a War of the Worlds of its time. It was a sci-fi cult classic in 1978 when Leslie Watkins first came out with it. And you know, he even opened that Pandora's box. And since then, you know, we've had a lot of serendipitous events as we went out on this journey and went out on this adventure to film this project. And one of those events was just the coming together with Leslie. You know, if we fast forward 40 years later now, Leslie, actually 2 weeks after we released our film, November of 2015, just recently, Graham Watkins came out of the woodwork, which was Leslie's son, and basically sent an email and said, you know, are you aware that we're getting ready to re-release Alternative 3? And this is 40 years after the original publication came out. And we had no idea. We didn't even know Leslie was still alive. We hadn't tracked it. We knew that, you know, we knew about the book. Frank had done a lot of research. We were embarking on this journey to bring people forward and whistleblowers forward on the topic. And then we discovered that Leslie not only was here, but he was re-releasing the Alternative 3 book literally 2 weeks after the launch of this film. So we teamed up. We assisted them with some of the art designs and the graphics, and we became, you know, you could call it a collaboration. And now, after 40 years, not only have they re-released Alternative 3, but I think Leslie's coming out of retirement to write a new book. Frank could get into
That's wonderful news.
It's fantastic news. And Frank could get into the mechanics of actually Alternative 3, because there's a whole concept behind this about people that have gone missing and also what Alternative 3 means. I mean, Alternative 3, there are three alternatives.
Yeah, I mean, basically, you know, the missing persons thing comes in a little bit later. The alternative threes are essentially the nutshell of the story is that there was in the 70s there was the start of what later what now is sort of like the household word global warming and expansion of population, and so there was a think tank of highly elite people that were looking at the problem of overpopulation and climate change to the point where they felt the planet was doomed and we needed to do something about it. And obviously when you're creating a kind of a Noah's Ark, you can't rescue everybody. So they began exploring some of the problems and solutions. The solutions would be alternative one was to blow massive holes in the ionosphere and try to cool the planet that way. But the problem was they didn't have the technology to seal them back up again. The second one was to build massive underground facilities to save some people from the impending doom, which they didn't pursue for some reason because they thought it would be too expensive. Although we all know now that this idea of, you know, deep underground military bases has been verified by many whistleblowers. The third alternative, which is the one they actually selected, was to go off planet and first to the moon, and from the moon they would go to Mars. So that was kind of like where it began, but they needed to get people onto Mars, and this is sort of where the missing people come into the problem. And maybe I should expand that a little bit on you know, on that whole thing a bit later on. I guess it's interesting because, you know, we were in Nexus just recently in Australia, where we had our Australian premiere of the film, and there was a speaker there that was going on about how every year, really, just, you know, thousands of people vanish mysteriously. Now, there are people that vanish because they want to vanish, but there's a lot of people that vanish under extremely strange and mysterious circumstances. They just basically disappear from one minute to the next, and nobody knows. Without a trace, nothing can be found there. They've basically been lifted into another dimension, almost, you could say.
Well, we are about to be lifted into another dimension because we have a break coming up here in just a minute or so. But, you know, I have a copy, like I say, of the Alternative 3. I guess it was shot off the TV screen there. A couple of editions of it floating around, all very grainy, all very poorly copied, I must say. There might be a better version of it on YouTube now, but certainly the listeners to the program tonight should go and take a look at it. I'm sure they'll be able to find it somewhere on the internet. And if not, I'll run you off a copy here in my big studio near the Empire State Building. And we'll all be back as a group. By the time we come back, we'll be on Mars.
Now back to exploring the bizarre with two of the most electrifying researchers in the paranormal, your hosts, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
All right, welcome back to the second section. I don't know what you'd call it. The next part of our program. We're talking about Mars and Alternative 3. And Frank, Tina, you know, whoever wants to tackle this, I just want to just, you know, briefly talk about the original program, Alternative 3, as it ran on Anglican TV. It's supposed to be part of a program called A Science Report, which was a, you know, legitimate nonfiction type of program. And I guess that Alternative 3 was originally intended to be an April 1st show. But because of contract disputes, you know, labor disputes, whatever, it got pushed back, and they weren't able to get it onto the ITV network, and so then they just threw it in at a different time, and just kind of freaked everybody out who saw it.
That's right. Well, the thing is, the show was, like, as you say, it was sort of like the last show of this nonfiction report, this called The Science Report, that did sort of weekly reports on the latest advancements in science. And when they decided to do this, they actually wanted to, the authors of the original program kind of wanted to, it's a mockumentary on the, you know, based around the idea that people will believe anything they see on television. So they really went, you know, out of their, you know, really went far, let's just say, to try and drive that point home. And yes, they had intended it to go out on April Fool's to kind of you know, drive that point home. But the problem was they had, as far as I understood from Leslie, there were some scheduling problems to fit it on that slot. I mean, the producers of the program wanted to have it on, but as it goes in networks with programming and sponsors and stuff, it just never worked out for them in April. And it did come out then later in June. And what happened is that when the show was aired, because people didn't really pay attention to the credits at the end, because they were used to seeing a show based on true events and developments in science, they didn't notice that there were actually actors listed in the rolling credits. And it was early on and early enough in television's history that they didn't have to put a disclaimer like the program you're about to see is based on, you know, fiction or whatever. They just ran it. Right. And people watching it, it was just like, I think they had 10,000 callers to the station meet the minute the program ended and absolutely outraged and flipping out that this is going on. And the television had to come out, the station had to come out and make a huge apology. And it became legendary. It really was Britain's War of the Worlds in a way. And Leslie Watkins, his publisher, came up to him and said, hey, wouldn't you want to write a book on this? This is cool. And Leslie actually had seen the program, even though he told me he never really watched television. This was one night where by chance he actually saw it. And he was amazed because he had himself really kind of been taking an interest in UFOs and space technology, that when he saw the program, he thought, okay, wait a minute, a lot of this stuff is, like, seems to be true. So when his publisher approached him with the idea of making the book on the show, he jumped at it, and of course, you know, the rest is history.
So now, the implications then is that, and it's, you know, it's obvious that the writers who wrote the original screenplay for this had done their research. I mean, they knew what they were talking about. They may not have believed what they wrote down, but obviously they had done their homework and ruffled some feathers somewhere along the line. So does this mean then, I mean, in your opinion, that our space program, you know, especially here in, you know, the Westerns, I can't really say about the, the former Soviet Union, is our space program a sham? Is it just a cover for what's really going on?
Well, when you set out to make a film like this and you want to base it around this concept of Alternative 3, now we didn't make a film that was, you know, like the film version of the book, but it was inspired by the book. And if you want to make a film about this, of course, you have to go out there looking for evidence to support the idea that indeed if there is actually something like this happening, then what is the space program that we're being shown on mainstream television about? Is that just like that obviously couldn't be reality? And there needs to be evidence that there is another reality out there. And indeed, when you start going out there, you find that there is evidence that what the space program is that we see is really just a huge PR program that keeps the rest of the population believing that we need to fire rockets, you know, the way we do to get people up out of orbit and to escape the Earth's gravity, that we still need to drive around carbon combustion engines to, you know, that have been 150-year-old technology, that even though we're running around with iPads and super slick, super slim tablet computers that can do like quantum calculations, we still haven't figured out a way to make motion and transportation anything but, you know, with wheels and burning of carbon fuels. So, you know, you start looking around at what's out there and you realize that there really is kind of a fictional version of reality which is presented to us in a simplified way using the mainstream and the educational system. And then there's reality. And the reality has gone so far from what, you know, the divergence between what we're taught and what we're shown has split so far from where it is that, you know, there is, there's actually been what, you know, we found with Richard Dolan describing as a breakaway civilization. This is a group of people that are, that have been on the cutting edge of developing this technology, some of it in Area 51, as you mentioned, that have essentially split from the rest of us, and they're using technology that makes, you know, what we're using now look like if we went back 100 years with a, with an iPad now and visited somebody in New York and showed them, you know, our Facebook and our videos being recorded, they would think it was magic. And of course, the technology that these people are playing with isn't iPads and iPhones, but it's actually teleporters and time travel machines.
Well, let me bring Tonia into this. I want to ask her now. Do you think that we first went to Mars? I mean, obviously, the TV show goes back to mid 1970s, but we were there before that.
You know, we were very fortunate in this journey of making the film to have the opportunity to interview a whistleblower down in Italy, Luca Scantamburlo. And Luca brought forward a lot of information, and also some of the other participants that had been a part of time travel programs, Project Pegasus with Andy Basiago. We learned about a project called Project Red Sun, which was a very interesting project, which is, we go into in the film, which definitely addresses the landing on the moon and when this was done, and were they actually those that had landed when they said that they had landed, or were they military astronauts? And what had happened with Mars? And did we have the technology then to go to Mars? And then with Andy Basiago, we actually set out and visited some of the time travel locations that he proposed in his project that he had experienced. And it was crazy. We were running around in the middle of nowhere in ghost towns, knocking on doors. We were fortunate to find people that had been in these locations for over 30 or 40 years to try to validate some of these sync points or these teleportation time travel locations, which went into traveling or jump room teleportation to Mars.
Yeah, so it seems like the thing is, the stuff, as you're hearing, seems to be going back about 40, maybe even 50 years. So I think, you know, the general perception is that the actual space program, this covert space program, began at least in the 40s and late 50s, and that Mars may have actually been visited starting in the late 60s. It's interesting that, you know, also there's evidence that, you know, there was basically a parallel program going on, where on the one hand there was the Apollo program, you know, and all these missions that were going on to get to the moon publicly, while on the other hand, even on another continent, they were developing means to move and bring people to Mars. So, and there was a lot of studio recordings that were done. There was filming done in studios. There was recordings that were done to, you know, this is up for debate. A lot of people feel that, you know, the strange, we've all heard about the strange shadows and anomalies and the pictures of the Apollo missions and landing on the moon that seemed not to add up to physics. That would indicate that things were shot in a studio, but for research we've definitely discovered that there was some studio recording going on, some filming going on. Now, what that means and everything. I mean, I think the idea of it all is to try and connect the dots. You know, so when we're making a film like this, to go out there after the premise that there really is bases on Mars and there really is kind of another space program, you have to add all these things together. On their own, they might seem like anomalous evidences that could be debunked, and a lot of them are attacked. But when you sort of thread all of it together, you realize that, hey, there really is something going on here.
What do you think about now? Tim and I worked on a book that we just recently published. It's called Nazi UFO Time Travelers. We found quite a bit of evidence that the Germans during the 1940s, or perhaps going even back earlier. Even before then.
Much earlier even.
Much earlier. Starting in 1933, the Nazis were down in Antarctica. They had basically been in touch. You know, I don't know if you want to believe this or if your listeners are going to go this far, but apparently the Nazis were actually had been contacted by an extraterrestrial race.
Well, we've talked about that. I was actually going back to the mid-1960s, writing about the craft that the Germans had developed, some of which were saucer-shaped. And, of course, everybody just totally ridiculed the idea at that time, you know. And the ETH, the extraterrestrial hypothesis, is still the strongest. No matter what evidence you present, that a lot of people, that's all they want to hear is that, you know, UFOs are from Alpha Centauri or Zeta Reticula or somewhere. They won't look anywhere closer than that, certainly not our own solar system. For many years, the UFO contactees were ridiculed for saying that they were, in touch with people from other worlds in our own solar system.
Well, you can't keep it you can't keep the truth out there. I mean, you can't keep it away from the public, I should say, forever. Eventually, it's going to drip through. And yes, I also agree that there's maybe a predominance of focus that these UFOs people are seeing are from other worlds. But early on in my life, I thought that there's a possibility they might actually be time travelers, or they might actually be terrestrial craft which had been developed.
Or interdimensional.
Yeah. Or interdimensional craft. So it doesn't necessarily have to come from far away. It could come from even the inner Earth. There's lots of, you had
Jim, yes,
in your program, who's been into this, and other people are. I mean,
Well, I've written, between Tim and I think we've done probably, we probably have the largest, as far as publishing companies go, have the largest number of books devoted to Richard Shaver, the Shaver mystery. We've reprinted Etta Dorfa. We've probably got 20 to 25 books devoted to the possible existence of the inner Earth. And Tim actually is one of the most knowledgeable authorities on Admiral Byrd and his supposed trip to the South Pole.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a fascinating chapter, too. Yeah. So we don't go into all that in the film, but this is all the stuff that kind of feeds the background. When you're doing your research to make a film, you want to make sure that there's some kind of meat to it, and then there's some foundation to it. And then people that are, when you're watching a film, you're seeing the tip of the iceberg. All the stuff that when you're putting together a 2-hour timeline, we could have easily made a 6 or 8 hour, thing by going into all these subjects in depth. But we just basically we show the tip of the iceberg and hope that the viewers can use all of the individuals or the particular events or subject matters as starting points for their own research. So, there's every single whistleblower in the film, there might be a super soldier in the film, but there's many super soldiers. And as we're learning, there's many, many more whistleblowers coming forward every day. Corey Good and Randy Kramer, these people weren't even on the map when we first started making the film. And once we got the film finished, they've all emerged, So it's like it just seems to be converging into the open, so that we will get to the bottom of what is really going on. I think the elite are feeling the dogs barking at their heels.
Now, who is part of this elite? In other words, if they are going to exit the planet at some point to save
their... Or have already exited the planet.
Possibly.
Yes, right, exactly. Well, Dwight...
I'd like to send a couple of them on a rocket to Mars.
I totally agree. I mean, go and disappear.
Right on the nose cone. Let's just put them on the...
Right, exactly. Put them up there. Yeah, President Eisenhower was the one that warned us about it originally. Yeah. There's this military-industrial complex which is running away. And the problem was the technology moved into the private sector. So who these people are is the, at best guess, there's a, they generally stay in the shadows and don't like their names to be put anywhere. I think that, Rothschild is about the closest, that you get to wanting to be even acknowledged in the mainstream as a powerful family. But I can assure you that name and that brand, let's say, is backed by a dozen other unknown people that you will never hear about.
Long as he brings a couple of good bottles of wine with him.
It's exactly. Okay. But it's like the magician's trick, show a couple of, wave your hand on one side, everyone's looking, and then while that's going on, you're doing something with the other hand quietly behind your back.
I think that when you talk about the idea of, say, like a secret space program, a lot of people, they conjure up visions of, flying saucers and anti-gravity devices. But a lot of the people that you have talked with and interviewed for your film, I mean, they are talking about technology that goes way beyond physical craft. I mean, we're talking about teleportation and time travel and other really seemingly far out science fiction type of stuff.
We were really, really fortunate to be able to interview Ernst Senkowski, who was actually in our film Solar Revolution. And he was a German biophysicist, he's a German physicist,
yeah,
and was the grandfather of instrumental transcommunication, which really he was like the godfather of like white noise, you know, speaking through the veil. And he had a lifetime of research, and we went and saw him. He has since passed. We were so very fortunate to actually capture him on film before he departed this realm. And he expanded on the technology and the device of the chronovisor. And I know we share this in quite a few interviews that we do, but it's so key and important technology because it ties into teleportation and time travel. And this chronovisor apparently was able to peer into actual timelines, and not only peer into our timeline or multiple timelines, it could actually peer in and had the capabilities. They had the capabilities of capturing it as though, you know, you stuck a, you know, camera onto a telescope. You could peer into a timeline and you could actually film the acacia, in a sense, I guess. It would be like if the imprint of an experience were to be left in an echo in the ether. They were able to actually photograph this echo, and it would come back like microfiche film, like black and white microfiche film, but they were able to actually go back to anchor points in time and capture this. This is like tangible, evidential proof of existing timelines or linear timelines. And they not only could go backwards in time, they could go forwards in time. And he talked a lot about this. He was in contact with Father Arnetti. He talked about how this technology had been seized by the Vatican. So it's a big controversy and question, where is this technology now? Some of our whistleblowers that came forward and talked about time travel and teleportation in the film brought up the chronovisor and how the chronovisor had been used in these time travel experiments and programs. So it's very interesting when we get into these, you know, technologies. And David Anderson, this is a whole nother subject in and of itself, with the experiments that he did with what was called the time warp generator. And this is just fantastic, this time warp generator. But we were very fortunate to have Ernst Senkowski in the film. He was a big supporter, a big fan, and he has since passed. But his work is just, I mean, he was like the godfather of where it all began before afterlife investigations. So this was really, I mean, the Skoll experiments and everything else, this was his life's work.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, you notice that there's a lot of science behind this stuff eventually. And, you know, it's not something that a lot of people really know about. But a lot of the science has been, taken out of the view of the public and moved into this private sector. But it really is a phenomenal stuff to really delve into.
Well, I know that Andy talks about how a lot of the technology that him and his father were involved with actually originated with Tesla research. I mean, and we're talking about, you know, the 19th and early 20th century.
Yes, absolutely. It's mind-boggling to think that there was this guy over 100 years ago who had figured out a way to use the magnetosphere of the Earth to, you know, move electricity around wirelessly, and he was the godfather of modern-day mobile telephone communication. And it was like people were still running around in horse buggies, and he was like, you know, communicating with extraterrestrials from another planet.
Well, and the thing that I find very interesting about all this, and, you know, like a lot of the people that you have interviewed for your film, is the consistency of their stories. I mean, you've got people who, really haven't talked to each other, yet they're telling the same kind of stories, you know.
Yeah, thanks. That was pretty amazing for us too. We felt that we really didn't, make a plan to pull all these people together and to work as a team. We actually thought, let's just find, the people that are going to come forward and talk to us. And amazingly, in the end, they all work together like a group that's actually revealing something, which it's a bigger picture. It's the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, as you might say.
We have 16 participants in the film, and not one of them knew about the other. So when we went out, we literally set up a camera, and we just allowed those participants to share their story and to speak their truth. It was never an intention to go out and leverage one person with another or to team up certain factions or research or work. We simply just said, wow, this is an amazing story. Let's go capture this. And even from a cinematic standpoint, you'll find in the film that there's a lot of close angles in the eyes and the face. And this was to really give the viewer a perspective into the soul so that we could actually get into the eyes of these whistleblowers that were telling these, in some cases, really incredulous stories.
Yeah, when they walk out of these programs, they many times don't have much more than the clothing on their back, and there's very little evidence. So, one of the things that, like Tonia says, that one of the techniques incorporated to try and get at whether it's true or not is this sort of own built-in BS detector, I think, that every human being has, but they use the eyes. If you look at someone's eyes and they're flinching or they're twitching or other little indications, you notice that, okay, you have this feeling of truth or not. And so I think that was one of the things that we absolutely wanted to show, is like deep into the souls and minds of these people.
Another big aspect.
Go ahead. I'm sorry, Tony. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say another big aspect too, in going out and approaching it from that standpoint, and we bring this up in the film, is cognitive dissonance. And, we encountered some of this. I mean, you meet these people and they're telling these stories, and you really have to ask yourself, truth is definitely stranger than fiction.
All right. Well, it's time for us to go to our top of the hour break. So when we come back, we will continue our conversation about the Mars and the secret space program. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Exploring the bizarre. Your e-ticket ride into the world of the paranormal. Strap yourself in as we traverse the universe, exploring the unexplained. UFOs, ghosts, lost worlds, cryptozoology, as well as other dimensions. It's time to take back the night. Now, your electrifying hosts of Exploring the Bizarre, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
You know, I wonder, Tim, do you think there's thunder and lightning like that on Mars?
Well, if you listen to, most astronomers, they say, no, there's not enough atmosphere for anything like that. But then, you hear other people who say that, yes, there is more of an atmosphere on Mars than anybody is letting on. So, I haven't been there, so I can't tell you.
Well, we've been on the red planet now, at least I have for an hour. And frankly, I expected to see a few more canals, because I know astronomers going back 100 or 150 years ago were seeing canals through their telescope. But
that was a translation mistake, Yeah, he didn't say canal. It was the word, I think it was
canali or something.
Canali, yeah, it meant channels. Uh-huh.
So what is it like on Mars? I mean, if we were there in the physical, what would we see all around us?
On the surface.
Well, let's start there.
I think essentially, one has to realize is that the sky that is depicted in the pictures that we've been fed from NASA all this time, which is always red or reddish, is actually more blue and bluish, similar to Earth's. That's one of the first things that I think you would notice. Secondly, you would probably notice that there's a lot of cloud movement that you wouldn't expect, because you would think that the pictures that are shown to us from in the recent NASA and JPL images is a dry and, you know, harsh, scarred environment. And it's interesting because if you look at the pictures that were shown to us, and we go into this in the film a little bit, if you look at some of the earlier telescope pictures, you actually see a lot more atmosphere, especially starting in the 60s, mysteriously. And this is also covered in the program Alternative 3. They actually show that there was a sudden, a lot more activity on the planet starting in the 60s, a lot more atmospheric activity, which apparently may have been the early stages of the reintroduction of atmosphere and bioforming that they began at that point when they started to build these bases. Now, the surface of the planet is reddish. It is sort of like a Sedona, kind of a red or whatever, as far as we understand. But a lot of the and there's evidence all over the surface of the planet of ancient artifacts and ancient civilizations, which we also talk about in Packing for Mars. And the thing is, a lot of these recent developments on the planet, they're using below the surface as their place to hide the evidence or hide the technology. And in some cases, they're moving back into facilities which have been dormant or which were there previously, which they're now renovating. In other cases, they're actually building new facilities into lava shafts and things like that. I mean, we've now, after we've released the film, been approached by researchers which have come forward and verified or talked to us about their own whistleblowers that are telling them that, yes, they've been involved. We are on Mars. They've been involved developing the technology to carry heavy machinery up there since at least the 70s. And they're using these lava shafts to build these bases into. So I think, and this apparently, I mean, what you can see also is that there is there's liquid, not just the liquid, you know, drippings that NASA is showing us in the pictures that they finally, after 30 right. years, have, you know, come forward, even though they knew it all back then, that there is water on the surface and admitted. But there's a lot more water on the surface than they would have us believe there is, for sure. One thing I wanted to say while we're here on the topic, I just noticed that we hadn't mentioned this, but for your listeners, for the first 50 of your listeners, we've set up a coupon for on Real House for Packing for Mars. So if those people want to stream and rent the film, they can get a 25% discount by putting in the word "The Bizarre" when they're checking out. I thought that we should mention that.
And how did they get to actually, I went to Real House today.
Well, if they go to our website, you know, on the red tab of our website, there's a direct link to go to the Packing for Mars Real House page.
It's www.packingformarsmovie.com, and then there's a rent tab there, so you can access that.
Yeah, you have quite an active website there. I read a lot of the material, and there's reprints of articles and interviews that you've done, and
yeah, it grows every single day. We're constantly updating the thing. It's always up to date, and we're adding more things as we go along. We just published the Leslie interview, and we're hoping to do some more of those, especially in light of the fact that we're finding out really interesting things now that we've put the film out there.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I always felt the film would be a stepping stone to catalyzing more events and more whistleblowers to come forward.
It's actually been quite an adventure since we released the film, because we've had people coming out of the woodwork giving us even more information. We've done several television interviews here in Germany releasing some of this information, but we're talking about high-profile people in the government, high-profile people at the patent office, high-profile even military astronauts, and some very low-profile, never had been before released whistleblowers coming out, giving us information, constituting and validating some of the stories. So that's been very, very interesting for us. It almost leads us to want to do another Packing for Mars 2, But like Frank was sharing with regards to the atmosphere, you know, Duncan is in the film. He talks about his experiences on the surface and the atmosphere. J.J. Hurtak, who wrote The Keys of Enoch, who's an astroarchaeologist, talks about the comparisons of our structures and our archaeological structures and complexes here and how they're mirrored on other places like the moon and Mars. And also Linda Moulton Howe really shared some interesting information, which we actually put in the film. It was a presentation she had given at Roswell, and everyone knows that famous face on Mars.
Oh, yes.
And one could say, yeah, it was, you know, a lot of the skeptics say it was a play on light and shadow. And then there are others, well, no, it was really something, you know. And she was led into a facility, I think, in Boston. And she went into this facility. I mean, it was a high top secret facility. She had to have special clearance. She went in there, you know, it was a whole ordeal for her to go in. She explains this in the film. But I was even surprised by her testimony, because she basically says that she saw firsthand these images that were being shown to her, and she saw the face. And the face actually had eyes with a pupil and an iris, and in the mouth you could see teeth. I mean, when I heard this, it was like, this isn't like a play of, you know, shadow and light, which obviously we've all seen the multiple different dynamics and angles of this. And as a filmmaker, you look at it and go, okay, well, I have to remain, you know, open to either, you know, aspect. But with her, she's literally saying, you know, she's seen these images, these top secret facility images, and literally could see the detail down to that finite, as in having teeth and an iris and a pupil, not in color, but actually you could actually see that level of detail. And you don't hear about this in the public. You know, this is not something that's disclosing.
No, and you don't hear about the prevalence of structures on the surface of Mars, which align and correlate to
pyramids
and structures on the Earth, which indicate that there really seems to have been a very intimate connection between our two planets at one point in history. I think that, you know, some of the guests that you had on recently were talking about sort of calamitous events that came through cosmic influence that brought, you know, like there were supernovas or debris fields which came through. And there's been a cyclical pattern of cosmic events which seem to have renewed or basically tore down and then forced rebuilding of things. But it's clear that there was this deep connection between Earth and Mars at one point in history.
So what you're basically saying then, at some time in Mars's past, there was an intelligent civilization there.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's. I mean, from what we've researched and we've seen, that everything seems to point in that direction. And there's no reason not to believe it. I think that we're living in a time now where a lot of this information is coming forward, and we're allowing ourselves to study it and analyze it. And there's like 368 or 69 different words in the human language which are based around Mars. And there's legends, you know, in our Earth's history from Marduk and to others that are talking about this red civilization, this red-skinned race that was here on Earth. And I think we're allowing ourselves to explore things where perhaps we weren't so eager to. I mean, one of the things that we had to cut out of the movie really was Richard Dolan eloquently expanding on the idea of the academic world poo-pooing anyone who does any kind of research into the subject of UFOs or other, like, you know, strange paranormal events. And that was, for a long, long time, I think, what kept a lot of the research from getting out there. But now with the internet, with a lot of amateur researchers that are becoming actually real pros, we've found out that with quantum physics and with paranormal events, that they're not so paranormal after all, that actual multiple dimensions overlapping are the cause of anomalies that would never be able to be explained in the old world model. And we're moving into a new world model now that is allowing us to kind of see a more holistic and complete view of the history of our planet and the history of and the reality of science.
You know, I wanted to ask you about Credo Mutwa's involvement in the movie. Now, for listeners who may not know who Credo is, he is an African shaman who's taken an interest in, inner earth, serpent race, UFOs. In fact, I know for we had a DVD set, like, you know, 6-hour compilation interviews with him. Very, very fascinating individual, certainly very colorful. An elderly statesman for the tribe. Is he still alive?
Yes, I believe he is still alive.
Uh-huh.
We were fortunate to get the footage and images from Dr. J.J. Hurtak, who had a relationship with him, and he shared some of the anomalies like the pyramids and its connection to these other worlds and the similarities between these structures. And Credo, I know not only Dr. Hurtak, but I know David Icke had some long journeys with and interactions with. It's great to connect with indigenous tribes on this because they're wisdom keepers. We brought in Bikbai into the film because we wanted to have a spiritual component as well. It's so important. It's science and spirituality. And Bikbai is a Dogon initiate, and he brought in the information from the Dogons and discussed our world and the worlds that are nearby us and the connection even with Sirius.
Well, it's interesting. Yeah, the Dogon basically have a history that indicates their knowledge of astral bodies that were impossible for them to know. There were no telescopes around back when these things entered into their legends. So they would have had to know something that we don't know, that we discovered many, many centuries later. So again, this connection between the stars or other star races and the Earth's history seems to be a topic which has only just broached the surface. We're looking at things that, you know, I think particularly with the reason we had JJ in the film is because he's really one of the originators. He's one of the people with really high-level contacts at JPL really early on, and he has actually been one of the sort of forefathers of putting this information together and publishing the information. And at the time that he put it out, of course, he was also basically ridiculed or blacklisted because they don't want this information out. They're drip feeding us a lot of this information. And it's interesting that there seems to be a lot of disinformation that's put out there, which is one of the themes in the film. We really look at how, you know, there's information that's out there already, which is true, but it's been contaminated with, and so people look at the contamination as evidence that it's not real. But in fact, there seems to be a code emerging, not just that there's all this material out there, but there's actually a code involved in publishing this information, which indicates little pieces of the puzzle for those who are willing to look at those to leave us the breadcrumbs in history so that in the future, when it's safe to finally talk about the fact, you know, that Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin may not have been the ones who landed on the moon, but actually were on their way to Mars at the time that the moon landings were being broadcast to us on Earth.
Now, I think that's the first time I've heard that.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, that they were on their way to Mars and not to the moon?
Yes, absolutely.
Project Red Sun, Lucas Cantabrillo goes into this aspect and the timings of the moon landings and the mission to Mars and the play of who really went where and could military astronauts could have been those that we were seeing actually filmed and introduced.
Without giving away for the viewer or listeners, in the film, we cover that subject in the film, and it's a revelation which has never been revealed anywhere else. It's the first time ever that somebody published this information from their from having been given this from a whistleblower about that whole chapter in the history of the space program with Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong and the Apollo missions, the 19 and 20 missions, and what was really behind those and what was really going on.
Lucas Cantabrillo came in at the very end. We were actually considered the film to be almost done, and Lucas came to the picture. And, you know, when we went to go film him, He was willing to speak with us, and he was open to speaking with us. In the end, he was very gracious and actually gave us a lot more than we ever anticipated. But it was interesting. He would only give us his coordinates. We actually had to drive to a specific coordinates down in Italy longitude and latitude and a cross point. He would not share with us where he was. He was, in a sense, in hiding. He still is. We are not allowed to disclose his exact location. And he opened up his you know, treasure troves, you could say, and shared a lot with us.
He'd been
footage
working,
and photographs and missions and things that he had
Well, his connection was to the Vatican, and he'd been working, he'd been also working with another Italian researcher called Cristoforo Barbato, who had actually been the one who a whistleblower from the Vatican had contacted originally to discuss the secret Vatican space program, SIV, you know, and the Project Silhouette. S-I-L-O-E, which was basically developed in the Vatican to pursue Planet X, because the Vatican's been, of course, very much interested in the cyclical return of this Nibiru. And there's a lot of information out there, of course, and a lot of interest around the subject of Nibiru. See, this is one of the subjects, again, we put in because we were looking, you know, for reasons why the alternative three premise would be you know, could exist in the modern context, and what are those events? They might be like, you know, Earth changes. They might be the approach of a celestial body, and what developed out of our contact with Lucas Cantamburlo was not just that the Apollo stuff, but in turn, but he actually had gathered a lot of information and footage that the Vatican had filmed of this approaching planet. And including calculations and things that have gone out of the mainstream. What's really amazing about that whole sighting of this planet X in the 80s, which made major headlines all around the world, some of the leading astronomers were basically proclaiming that they found it because of the secret, you know, they'd noticed a deviation of one of NASA's probes into space, and they went to investigate that, and that led them to make the discovery. And it was being hailed all around the planet for years, and suddenly they all went quiet. It just went dark, and the subject became taboo. And then mysteriously, really, I mean, we didn't put this in the film, but in the research, there's been dozens of astronomers who have died under very mysterious circumstances. And ironically, the majority of them were the ones who were supporting and had made discoveries based around this approaching planet.
I know a friend of Tim Beckley's and myself, a guy by the name of William Michael Mott, he tells a story that he was talking with an astronomer, and this astronomer was, you know, very friendly and open to talking about life on other planets and the possibility of UFOs and everything like that. But as soon as Mike brought up the subject of Planet X, he said this guy's demeanor just changed. He said that, you know, he just got that look in his eyes and just refused to talk to him anymore. He just walked away. And, so I mean, it's obvious there's something going on with that.
Cristoforo Barbato, he vanished off the radar. He's gone, and he used to be a soccer star, and then he became a journalist, and then he vanished, and then the information went to Luca. And Luca, basically, like Tonia said, he was extremely secretive. He would not meet us at his house. We had to go arrange geographic coordinates before he would he felt that this was a good project that he would get involved in, and he wanted to reveal information which he'd never been able to reveal. But at the same time, he wanted to make sure that his family was safe. It was really bizarre. And we also know that he knows Bill Ryan and Carrie Cassidy, who went to interview him on the subject a few years earlier. And they have their own story that when they were, after they had seen him, they went to park their car and fly up to, Amsterdam. And when they came back from their flight, their car had been totally ransacked and trashed. So there is an embargo on that particular subject. It's very, very sensitive. I mean, most people don't even know that the Vatican has a secret space program. Now, I mean, I think they've done a good job just kind of diverting attention from the matter, but I think it will be something which is going to be visited again in our lifetime very soon. And, you know, we have Jerry Wills also in the film talking about his the things that he was told. As you know, he described to you that he had many meetings with the pilots of these craft. And some of that information, of course, is what he shared with us in the film.
And those that were on Mars and why they departed and what happened to their civilization and what happened here.
What about these private commercial companies that are trying to put together some sort of space program so that they can take people to.
Well, we were told that by a whistleblower that had contacted one of the researchers, which had been in touch with us since releasing the film, that indeed those people that are going to arrive as the second wave of the space pioneers, the private space ventures, when technology reaches the point where, like with filmmaking, it'll be space travel that everyone will be able to do, they're going to land on the surface of Mars and be greeted by the natives who are going to help them set up their bases up there.
Well, there you go.
And we were also told that by the same physicist, indirectly, that the analogy they made was that we on Earth now are like living like the grasshoppers in summer who are unaware that winter is coming.
And
that's a nice scenario.
so is our last commercial.
Well, it isn't a nice scenario. The thing is, that's funny. A lot of people tell us, wow, this movie is great. We love it. And I'm like, you shouldn't love it, man. It's scary. It's like actually scares the hell out of you. You know, it's not something that you can love. It's shot beautifully, but it is heavy duty material.
Well, we are coming upon our last break, and we will be back very shortly with Tonia and Frank and Tim. And I'm Tim Beckley, and you're listening to Exploring the Bizarre.
Back to Exploring the Bizarre with two of the most electrifying researchers in the paranormal, your hosts Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Well, you know, we've just taken off from the planet Mars, Tim, and we're headed back to Earth.
We're taking the slow way home.
Well, you know, we have with us tonight Frank Jacob and Tonia Madenford, and we're talking to them, and they're in Bavaria, and we're in New York and in Jasper, Indiana, and our audience is spread out all over the planet, and perhaps a few in motherships hovering overhead. You know what I wanted to ask, and either one of you can get into this, tell us a little bit, as far as you know, about the history of Mars. Was there Martian life there? At one point, is there still local inhabitants? And what are some of the major events that have drifted back through time regarding the Red Planet?
Well, it's evident from some of the researchers that we were studying, making the film, that there is this ancient civilization that had existed on the planet. And even NASA now admits that there was evidence of massive bodies of water on the planet, and that some celestial event seems to have taken place, loosely around, let's say, 12,000, 13,000 years ago, which basically created the changes on the surface of the planet that have led it to become what we now have. And a lot of the water has seemingly gone under the surface and been trapped underground. And this is what they were basically accessing when they started doing the terraforming on the surface of the planet. So there's that part of it. And the other thing is that there seems to be a cyclical, as we were talking earlier in the break, a cyclical pattern of celestial events, things that come from space and directly affect us. They could be supernovas. They could be super mega flares from the sun. They could be Nibiru, all these things. They seem to be indicators of great changes which took place. So, you know, as far as we've been told in our research, that whenever these events happen, they're the most advanced aspect of civilization left the planet, but also certain people stayed behind. Certain ones stayed behind to help those here that were staying on the planet, and I think that there's evidence that, of course, there was this same kind of a civilization that was left behind on Mars, and we've also now learned from some of the other whistleblowers that have come forward, like Corey Good, that there still is this collaboration, and we've actually contacted some of these people in recent times.
And these great cataclysmic events actually leave an imprint in the genetic memory, in the genetic code. And as we were talking about during the break, we mentioned this in the film about even legends talking about a priest named Mu that warned the people of Mars that a great event was going to occur. And some did evacuate and many did perish. And if you look at even what they called the priest Mu would basically stand for, you have Mu and Lemuria and Atlantis. This is all indicators and sync points in our genetic memory. And it also shows how we're all interconnected, even within our own solar system.
You know, one of your guests was asking about the bases on the moon and Mars, and you know, John Lear's claims, and these bases that are up there do exist. And in fact, one of the people that approached us after when we won our Ebby Award was a civilian astronaut who had been involved in training the Apollo astronauts
Ken
during
Johnson.
That whole program, Dr. Ken Johnson. And he's come forward now with some material photographic evidence that actually verifies the pictures that Jose Escamilla had put out in some of his films.
I've done several films with Jose. Jose's an amazing director. He was one of our 16 participants in the film. We did Moon Rising. We did Celestial, UFO Greatest Story Ever Denied. He just released his most recent film, UFOs from Outer Space. And we go into the bases on Moon, and we go into the anomalies on Moon. And in Packing for Mars, we talk about how the Moon was a springboard location to Mars. And we get into even Project Red Sun and the reason for the connection between the moon and Mars element with regards to travel and with regards to, you know, basically basing and moving forward to these other locations. And with Jose's work, he gets right into this. Now with Ken Johnson, Dr. Ken Johnson, when we were doing Moon Rising and Celestial, we were introducing the smudged photographs from the moon, large areas, sometimes the size of Los Angeles, that were smudged out. And we showed these images in the film. And Jose shared even some of this in with Packing for Mars. Ken Johnson actually came forward, and this was very interesting for us, and this was after the film was released. He came forward and showed us images, because he had been at JPL and NASA and had some of these photographs.
Yeah,
he was in charge of photographic archive. In fact, they made jokes because they were called the strippers, the professional strippers, because they were the guys that would go in and actually smudge out these photographs. But what was interesting with Ken Johnson's images is he had the photographs before they were smudged. So here we had done all these films with Jose about all these smudged photographs and what is this and anomalies and things that are being hidden. And then Ken took it a step further and said, well, this is the image before they were smudged. And it's shocking. We just did a television show here in Germany at Lebenskraft revealing some of these images. Literally, you can see aerial photographs of full-lit cities on the moon.
Yeah, and we cover some of it also on the Mars. We don't go into too much of it because it's a long subject in itself. There's a lot of photo forensics that are happening along those lines right now, where people are uncovering debris and things on the surface of Mars. And what's interesting is that there really is this whole, what's clear, and what's clear from Dr. Ken Johnson, is that there actually was this department in the photographic archive of people that were systematically brushing things out of pictures. There's no longer any dispute about this. And when you realize that, you realize that all of these surface structures that we're uncovering, they're basically clearly showing that what's going on the surface is a lot different from the official story.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's Barry from California also wanted to know if you had heard anything about, he says Captain K. I'm not.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Captain
Randy
K,
Kramer.
You know, what's interesting about these guys is that they both seem to be, both Randy Kramer and Corey Good seem to have been participants in this secret space program simultaneously without having been aware of each other. So there's this whole independent evidence thing. Now, Corey's story is interesting because we learned, and I really suggest Michael Sala's new book about the secret space program. It's fantastic. We got really, you know, he's really delved a lot more in depth on than we were able to cover in the movie on this stuff. But basically, it's clearly what happened is that they were using both time travel and age regression techniques that they'd been provided to from extraterrestrial technology to hide their program, to move soldiers, because they couldn't have these soldiers coming in for a tour of duty that lasted 3 to 4 years. They needed these guys to be in there for 20 years because it took them 3 to 4 years just to train them to be able to handle these off-world programs that they were developing. So they would have to do tours of 20 or 30 years. And they were given the what enticed them to enter the program is that they were told that they would be age regressed after it was over, and it would be like nothing had ever happened.
So they'd served 20 or 30 years and completely age regress. It's interesting. Andy talks about this in the film. They actually used the time travel program itself to reveal the time travel route. They used time travel to hide the time travel program. And it's interesting because with regards to this age regression that Michael Sola now talks about in his research in this upcoming book or his new release book, he talks about this age regression. And in most cases, the memories were wiped. So these guys would get recruited. They'd serve 20 or 30 years, and then they would age regress. They would get age regressed, their memories would be wiped, and they'd be back to right where they started. So they're using the program to disclose the program or to hide the program itself. And I guess in the case of, in some cases, their memories weren't entirely wiped.
And the difference between Corey, the difference between Corey Good and Randy Kramer is that Randy Kramer came back and had his memories like wiped, and he didn't actually start recovering those memories until 17 years later. They began to bleed back in. But Corey Good allegedly had retained at least 80% of the memories, so the wiping program was not successful with him. And in the course of the last few years, he's really, you know, recalled pretty much the, you know, the kind of level of detail that can only be recalled by somebody who was a direct participant. And both of them are now coming forward, of course, with stories that really do corroborate that this kind of level of technology has been employed and deployed. You know, the idea of wiping people's memories and sort of, you know, like a kind of a mental lobotomy that took out chunks of memory is a viable, legitimate psychological tool that's been incorporated for many, many decades. Leslie Watkins talks about a lot of that in the book Alternative 3, which you should, by the way, really read. It's a really riveting re-release.
It just goes to show how mainstream Hollywood and mainstream television programming is really revealing the truth between the cracks. I mean, this is age regression, and what Michael Sola is talking about in his research in his new book is no different than Fringe. I mean, these television programs like Fringe and Heroes and what was the time travel one with Outlander?
The Outlander.
I mean, there's so many in Penny Dreadful, and you get into all these incredible, Lucifer even, and then mainstream Hollywood movies. I mean, we just encountered at Nexus some incredible information. Duncan Rhodes is brilliant, and he's done so much research over the years. He was even on the Alternative 3 case, but he disclosed some things to us that is happening down in Africa that totally ties in with some of the new information that's being revealed now in television series like Fringe, but also like old films like Jodie Foster with the looking glass technology in Contact. I mean, they are doing this in Africa. The underground technologies that are there, I mean, Hollywood basically is a mirror of disclosure, whether it's Avatar,
soft
Men in
disclosure.
Black, soft disclosure, yeah, Men in Black, Avatar, you know, all these other films, Matrix. These are all ways of introducing ideas and theories and truths.
Another way that
in a cloak of like science fiction.
Exactly.
We did that with Stranger at the Pentagon. We you know, science fiction, but it really was science fact. When we talked about Valiant Thor coming to the planet, all that occurred there.
Well, we were good friends with the Frank Strangest. Whenever I would have a conference, you know, UFO or paranormal conference, Frank for years was our always our master's of ceremony, you know, our host for the event. Probably one of the best platform speakers on the subject. I mean, just a master at delivering an address to an audience.
Yes, and you know, you have to really ask yourself, like, these people that are coming forward with the information that sounds so crazy, you know, what is their incentive? What is their motive? For the most part, many of them are not getting money for what they're doing, or if they are, it's barely enough to survive on. Many of them are face disrepute with their colleagues if they're scientists or if they're researchers. So I think there's just this general need that certain individuals feel, And, you know, we hear this in a lot of cross-pollinating subjects with respect to that we have covered in Packing for Mars. Like, we didn't really get into hybrids, but there's a lot of hybrids emerging that are talking about there's this impending need to disclose information. There's a lot of, and, you know, speaking of Duncan Rhodes, he told us some riveting stories about this stuff in Africa. There's people that are in these secret covert programs whose job it is to peruse the forums online and gaming platforms and gaming forums and dripping actual real information into these things that sounds absolutely crazy, just to gauge the level of reactions that they can decide whether they're going to disclose something more publicly or whether they're going to hold back on that information. So it's just fascinating what's going on right now.
Well, I think that people are a lot more open now to the reality of this kind of stuff than they were, say, you know, even 10 years ago. I think that if you talk to most kids, teenagers, about the reality of life on other planets, or even, you know, that we're being visited, you know, by extraterrestrials in flying saucers, I think a lot of them would be surprised to find out that, you know, that evidence hasn't been verified yet. You know, I think they already think it's real.
Yes, I think that, you know, really, I think it's in our collective, like we were saying in the break, there's this morphogenetic field. And as we were told when we were at Nexus by one of the people down there seems to be a morphogenetic field which is bleeding through that some of us who are more sensitive are picking up on already of some major event which is just around the corner. It's manifesting itself, you know, in our material world in, you know, predictions of global financial collapse or global climate collapse, or, you know, major unrest among people from refugee movements. And I mean, basically the feeling is there that, you know, that something's going to go off soon. And I think it's all relative and part of this whole bleed through from a morphogenetic level of something that's coming.
Well, I think actually that the stuff that you talked about, you know, in your film, the secret technology, to me, it makes a lot more sense than the idea that NASA is still flying spacecraft, allegedly, that is using 1970s computer technology, that everything's still being put on the floppy disk and things like that.
Yeah, exactly. Well, this is no longer going to be... I think what's happening is that because of this private sector developing rapidly, it's forcing disclosure on a lot of topics, and it's speeding things up. And I think that, you know, essentially these elitists, which have kept the information to themselves for many decades, are feeling the urgency just like the rest of us. And it's going to be very, very difficult to stop, you know, the material from emerging into the public sector.
Well, now, Betty from Vegas wants to know, what's the one thing that surprised you the most from producing this film?
Ha ha, how deep does the rabbit hole go?
Yeah, and we only have a few minutes left, unfortunately, in the program. So.
Well, it's been great to be on your show. And again, you should, you know, tell your viewer, your listeners that we have set up a coupon on Real House. Just
you go ahead and tell them. Come on.
Yeah, I mean, for people who want to check out the film, it's available, of course, on DVD for those who want to have something in their hand. But if you go to our website, www.packingformarsmovie.com, you can access both the DVD and a 48-hour rental. And if you want to rent it and watch it right this second, because I'm sure you will, you can rent, you can put in the checkout process the word The Bizarre, THEBIZARRE, in upper caps, and you'll get a 25% discount.
Now, Betty, I just want to respond to Betty, because really it is how far down the rabbit hole. Every corner we turned, everybody that came to the table to share information with us, it was all just a surprise, an aha moment. And we had this with Solar Revolution too. It was aha moment after aha moment after aha moment. We are just out there on our own journey and adventure, just like the viewer. And we're just sharing what we discover. We don't have the answers. We're just out there seeking, just like you are. And I mean, there's so many extraordinary things, like even like David Anderson's time warp generator. I mean, apparently there are scientists standing around this time warp generator and they can see a rose, a full bloomed rose, pull back into a bud in real time. I mean, this is like seeing in real time time travel technology in motion. There's just, you could go on and on and on with the incredible things that we encountered while we were on this journey.
But it really is that the motto that the truth is stranger than fiction, I guess, would be the one thing that really, I mean, I don't know if you call it surprise, but, you know, when you have that sort of bent from a character, from a personality that where you think that you question things like I did at least, you never really know, you never really believe just how far it actually then does go. And the more you look at it, the more you realize that pretty much everything that we see in the public mainstream is pretty much 180 degrees the opposite of what's really going on. You know, so if they tell you one thing, it's really another thing. If they tell you there's no water on Mars, there is water on Mars. You know, if they tell you that they've closed down NASA, they've actually gone covert and they're actually ramping it up somewhere else. It's just, you know, we just have to be open and aware that and question things, because if we don't question things, we're going to be, you know, we have to be able to confront the cognitive dissonance which we've been programmed with. Cognitive dissonance, I'll just briefly mention what that is, because that's one of the themes in the film, is the notion that what you've been taught and your belief and your constructive reality is so diverse, it diverts so much from truthful information that you're confronted with, that you would rather hang on to the lie than to convert to accepting the true information, because it's usually a big shock for most people.
The key is to go out there and really just make known the unknown. Go on the grand adventure and just seek for yourself, because you'll find the answers.
Well, now, your movie will be opening in several cities. Are you taking the film on the road?
We actually are on the road. We just got back from our Australian premiere last week. It's screening in Greece, Sisyphos, next week. Yeah, and we've got CE5 is doing a screening on the East Coast. We keep our tour schedule updated, and we've had the opportunity of doing premieres even here with World Space Week in Austria, so we do get around the planet.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful.
Very premiere soon, so keep tabs on our tour page.
Hopefully, eventually, after you've hit all the theaters and rented on the online, that it'll be up on Netflix or somewhere.
Yeah, I mean, there's all those good things.
Oh, yeah. You'd
be up there with Penny Dreadful.
Yeah, right. Well, I'll watch yours first, believe me. In fact, I must say that this has been a fascinating 2 hours. I mean, time just flies so fast when you're in a teleporter.
Wow, yeah, it really did go fast, I have to say.
And I wish you much luck with your venture here, and I'm sure that you will open a few eyes along the way. Hopefully. Anything? What's your next project?
Well, people ask us that a lot, and we have actually, you know, we have no shortage of products. I think we have about 6 projects which we could dive into. But right now we've been, you know, we realized, we sat back after completing Packing for Mars and realized that we'd actually produced 4 feature documentaries in the last 5 years, as well as about 30 half-hour shows for called Ultimate Rush for Red Bull. So we've actually, you know, thought it's time to just kind of, you know, lay back and market a little bit and push this stuff out there, because information needs to get out.
We are going to do Packing for Mars in German subtitles, which we're working on next. We're tantalizing French. We did Solar Revolution in French and German and English. So their next project is Packing for Mars in German subtitles. And we are going to be doing something with Klaus Dohna. We did Klaus Dohna Chronicles 1. He's got a lot of expeditions. He's great. He's an adept artifacts researcher. He's into Uparts, out-of-place artifacts. We're going to be meeting with him shortly. And we will be looking at doing another Klaus Dohna Chronicles 2.
Well, you know, you guys are so busy. And I'm glad you could speak with us from Bavaria. It's been a great show, and I know we're going to get a lot of feedback from this. And, of course, Tina will have it, our producer will have it up in archives in just a couple of hours on kcorradio.com. And then you can look forward to the version on YouTube, where we probably add maybe even your trailer up there on it, because Peter's in charge, and he always does a great job with the graphics and expanding everybody's horizon. So that's Mr. UFO's Secret Files.
Very cool.
Thank you, Tim and Tina. You guys rock.
Yeah, you guys are awesome.
Hey, we've been doing this for so many years. It's like we've been on Mars.
I'm sure you've been further than that, even.
Maybe so. I won't tell you where I've been, but you can probably guess. And Tim Swartz there in Indiana, I will be talking to you probably tomorrow about our new book that we're finishing up on, the alien mind control.
That's right.
And we got another book coming out on dogmen and a lot of different things. My goodness. Just look us up on Amazon.com.
You've been listening to Exploring the Bizarre with hosts Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz. They're taking back the night by jetting non-stop across the cosmos in search of the truly bizarre and totally unexplained, with you as their co-pilot. Thursday nights at 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern. On the KCOR Digital Radio Network. For more information on Exploring the Bizarre and hosts Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz, check out their KCOR Digital Radio Network page. Follow their YouTube channel at MRUFO 1100. Exploring the Bizarre.